Peace, this is Pete here. What I'm going to do today is do a breakdown on the creation stories as it was documented by Ramon Panay, La Casas, and Perito Matier. So basically what I'm doing is an overview on the first half of Panay's account, which basically is breaking down how Taino society came to be. So, one of the first things I want to put out there is, in order to understand Panay's account, you can't look at it from a literal sense. You know, like, there's a lot of authors that has did a lot of dissertations and gave their own thesis on interpreting Panay's document on the spiritual practices and beliefs of our Taino ancestors. And when you're reading it, you know, the first thing you have to understand is don't take it literally. Because if you're reading it literally, like looking at a timeline from a point A to point B perspective, you're not really going to get a clear picture. So what I did was I wrote a short overview on paper, which is going to later be in a document that I'm going to put out later down the road, somewhere down the road. And you know, I'm just going to give you a rundown in what each story represents. So here we go. So what I'm going to start off is there's a scholar, his name is Osvaldo Garcia Goco, and he says that in order to understand Panay's account, ethnological comparisons are necessary to comprehend what Panay was writing. So what does he mean by ethnological comparisons? Well, ethnological comparisons is a discipline of making our connections with other cultural disciplines, like many from South America, the Guaraníes, or anyone within the Arawakan family, or even the Tucano family, and vice versa. There's been many people that made many comparisons, such as Sebastian Romeo Lamacha, Walter E. Roth, even Eugenio Fernandez Mendez. There's a long list of scholars that made comparisons. Now, comparisons are necessary is for the fact that you'll be able to get a clear picture. Another example is Stevens Arroyo, okay? But the only difference is if you cannot create a picture in your mind, you're not gonna get a full overview in what each story is telling. So this is what I'm gonna try to do today, is to give you a picture in your mind so you can see for yourself. So we're gonna start at the very beginning. I'm gonna give you three examples. First by Panay, second by Las Casas, and the third by Perito Matier. Okay, so first we're gonna start with Panay. He says, "This is in the opening." He says, "In the beginning, they believe that he is in heaven, and is immortal, and that no one can see him, and that he has a mother. But he has no beginning. And they call him Yukahu Bawa Marakoti, and they call his mother Atebe, Yermau, Waka, Apito, and Suimako, which are five names." Okay, La Casas, he writes in chapter 120 of the Apologetic History, he says, "The people of Española have a certain faith in and knowledge of a one and true God who was immortal and invisible, for none can see him, who had no beginning, whose dwelling place and residence is in heaven. And they call him Yukahu Bawa Marakoti. That God has a mother whose name was Atabe, a brother Waka, and other relatives in like fashion." Okay, and now this is Peter Martier's take. He says that They believe the Semis are messengers from him who they confess is one, infinite, omnipotent, and invisible. Every kinglet, which he's using that word instead of us saying cacique, has his Semi who he worships. His ancestors gave to the everlasting God in heaven these two names, Ikuna Wamanokon. They say that the same God has a mother, called by these five names, to wit, Atabera, Mamona, Wakarapita, Yela, Waimosa. So at the very beginning, what they're doing is they're giving you an overview on how the Taino ancestors believed in spirituality. Like, you know, today we would say, we would use the word God to describe the supreme being. So in a sense, they have their aspects of describing the supreme being, which is the creator, you know, the mother. Some people will interpret as the mother and father, creator of the universe, the cosmic forces of nature, and vice versa. So this is giving you an overview of the primordial archetype in Taino society, which is venerated as a mother and father ancestor, who is the ancestor of all the other ancestral lineages in Taino societies, just to put it in a nutshell. Okay, now I want to give this real quick, just so you can get it an overview, right? There's this book by Sonia Rodriguez comparing the Semi, the three-pointed Semi, with that with the pyramids, right? And in one part, she writes this in her book. She says, Lokuo was happy on earth with all the beauty that surrounded him. He knelt before Yukahu to offer thanks. Waka looked with envy to all his brother created. He stole away to a secluded place and did nothing for a while, but his envy overcame him, and he began to taint the creations of his brother. He changed his name, becoming the terrible god of evil, Huracan. Now, from reading that, one thing you have to understand, if you get a clarity, Taino society is generated by a series of transformations, okay? And there are many examples, which I'm going to show you later, okay? Now, in the Taino hierarchy, there is no documented concept of an adversary, such as in the ancient Egyptian, you have Set kills his brother Osiris, which later becomes the archetype for good versus evil, and vice versa. In Panay's account, there's no such citation for an adversary. You know, now, Pierre de Martyr, La Casas, and Panay, they cite that from the primordial archetype comes, you know, the lineages of the families in Taino society, if you understand it, right? When they mention the five, when, for example, Predator Martyr, he mentions the five names, Atabera, Mamona, Wakarapita, Iela, and Waimosa, okay? La Casas, he says, Atabe had a brother, Waka, and other relatives in like fashion. Panay, he also says that, okay, and that the supreme being had a mother, right? It was called Atabe, Yermau, Waka, Apito, and Suimako, which are five names. So when you have, when you review that, you'll see there's no documentation for an adversary. So as we'll go along, you're going to see that how the structure of the Taino hierarchy is. Okay, so this is what we're going to do to break it down further. Okay, at another part, Eugenio Fernandez Mendez, he cites Jesse Walter Fuchs. Right, and this, and I think this is in the Aborigines of Puerto Rico. He says, on the basis of the historical and archaeological material available to us, we may assume that the people of the Antilles in ancient times believed in two supernatural beings called Semis, who were the ancestors of all the others. These two beings can be recognized as Atabe, the mother goddess, and Yukahu. All the other gods had their origin in these two. So with that said, this is given another correspondence in the breakdown of the Taino hierarchy. Another example to get a picture of this is studying any of the works that was published by Ra Unefer Amen. Right, which he uses the Tree of Life as a point of reference of social political development. So in a sense, if you can use that and superimpose the lineages of the Semis, you're going to see how it all connects. But these are just examples that I'm throwing so you can picture an image in your mind how all these themes can come about through visuals. Okay, so now we're going to break down concerning which the natives have come and in what manner. Now, I say that instead of using the word Indian, because Aram Jose, he says the word Indian is a European construct. Okay, when Columbus came to this hemisphere of the planet, he mistook the natives for being Indians because he thought he was in India, because he was looking... Allegedly, he was looking for the Grand Khan, so they say. So concerning in which they have come, right? And this is from the first chapter of Panay's account. Okay, he says, there is a province in Quisqueya. Okay, Quisqueya or Ati was the documented names for the island of Hispaniola, which Columbus changed the island as, you know, he made his so-called voyages. Okay, so I'm using the word Quisqueya instead of Española. Okay? So he says there is a province in Quisqueya called Caonao, in which there is a mountain called Cauta, which has two caves. The name of one of these caves is Casiba Hawa, and Ama Iauna the other. The majority of the people who populated the island came from Casiba Hawa. Now, Pietro Matier, or Peter Matier, he says that most of the men emerged from the widest mouth of the cavern, and a smaller number from the narrowest. Okay? So, basically, to put it in a nutshell, what this part of the creation story or the oral history, however you want to interpret it, you know, then basically you can, like, let's say, right, you're sitting in the fire, right? It's at night, you know, you're in the middle of a forest, an island, in a remote island, you know, and you're around people you've never encountered for the first time. It's all new. So, in a sense, Panay could be considered as a child, which they were telling a bedtime story to. And in a sense, because he didn't fully comprehend their language and intellect, you know, so, you know, they were trying to undermine a task where they were trying to, you know, tell their story to a child, you know. A child's not going to really get it at first. You know, maybe later when he gets older, he's going to understand it. So I'm just using that example to explain the setting and what they had to do to, you know, tell their story. You know, so basically, the part with the caves is just a part in the account where it's telling, you know, how the people came to be on the islands. Eugenio Fernandez Mendez, he says, right, there are historical records of contacts between the islands and the continent, both to the north, the west, and the south. Okay. Another example from Irving Rose. He says, the West Indies were evidently peopled in two directions. First by the Casimiroids from Middle America, and then by the Otoroids from South America. Now remember, whenever you hear these terms, especially like Salidoid, those are technical terms to describe migrations of peoples in the Caribbean region. Okay? The former migration began about 4,000 BC, and the latter about 2,000 BC. The Casimiroids are natives from the Yucatan, and the Otoroids are natives from South America. So these are technical terms as they use pottery or in various other methods to date the migrations of peoples in the Antilles, okay? So the people came from two directions, one from the Yucatan and one from the Orinoco region into the Lesser Antilles and into the Greater Antilles, which are not excluding also from Florida, right? Irving Rose, he says, there they established a frontier with the Casimiroid peoples, which lasted from 1000 to 400 BC. That is until the arrival of the Salvadores, forebearers of the Tainos. So if you can picture in your mind the story, or the narration of the caves, right? Well, you can see that the describing is all the various tribes or communities that came together to create Taino society, as it was as Columbus arrived on the Antilles during the age of the conquest. Eugenio Fernandez Mendez, he cites, we have deliberately omitted, for the most part, unwarranted. Wait, let me correct that. He says we have deliberately omitted, for the most part, as unwarranted, a careful or detailed study of Taino chromatics, which is pottery, which mostly has its roots in South America, as well as other aspects of Taino cultural base, which is Arawakan, right? The language, which you make the comparison to Kalinago, Garifuna, and Locono, and the material culture, the kasabe, the hammocks, the canoes, you know, those are all Arawakan base. And he says, also with evident South American affinities, which you will find a comparison in religious and also material culture, which the Greater Antilles has in relationship to South America, in the South American region, the Orinoco region. Loida Figueroa, she makes a note in History of Puerto Rico. The Ineti culture, older than the Taino, she says, was highly skilled in pottery making. The bowls from this approach were strong, hard, and thin, she says. They used to paint them using preferably red, green, and white, The designs were usually geometric, showing a stylized art. This skill was not applied to stone working, used among other things for making arms and religious objects. Okay, now just to get an understanding of that in a nutshell, okay, there's two parts. There's the discipline in chromatics, pottery making, which they were greatly known for, Italian ancestors were known for, and also working with stone, which they were very advanced. One of the most advanced artwork came from Borinquen, which is today's called Puerto Rico, and also from Haiti and the Dominican Republic. Okay, that's when you find most of the advanced artwork, which I am referring to the stone making, such as the three-pointed semi, which is not an accurate term to call them, you know, because they should be called a semi by their appropriate name, you know. When you call them a three-pointer, it's pretty derogatory. It's like calling a brother a Negro. So, you know, I would refrain from using those terms. Okay. So, in another part, Loyola, she also says, in stoneworking, the Taino culture reached an excellent level. So, when you get an understanding of this and connecting with the story of the caves, you know, Taino society was complex because it represented a community of peoples. You know, and so it didn't just came from one area. So, you know, just to put in your mind, you know, a concept that's represented as a semi, you know, to create and develop something that is so poetically expressed as a semi, you know, you have to have long periods of development and prosperity to create something like that. So that's something I want to throw in there, you know, so you can keep in mind, you know, because it needs to be acknowledged. All right, so Loyola, she also says that Brenton points out the closeness between two cultures, the Carib or Kalinago and the Taino, are great, and there are more than just similarities than differences. Okay, so this, I'm just throwing various things out there. You know, in a later report, I'll have more of a technical breakdown, which, you know, you will see, you know, where the sources come from. So this, I'm just throwing a nutshell so you can get the picture. Okay, so when dealing with the caves, right, this is another part by Panay. He says, when they were living in those caves, the people stood watch at night. And they entrusted this task to a man by the name of Macocarel. Because one day, he was late in returning to the door, they say the sun carried him off. Because the sun had carried away this man, for his lack of vigilance, they closed the door against him. Thus it was that he was turned into stone near the door. Afterwards, they say, others who had gone to fish were captured by the sun, and they were changed into trees, which they call hobos. The reason why Macocarel was keeping watch and standing guard was in order to see where he would send or distribute the people. And it seems that he tarried to his great misfortune. So, what did they mean by that? It means that as they were attempting to leave the cave, each time they left the cave, the cave of creation or the cave of origin, you know, there was a magical transformation. You know, so in a way, it's describing all these peoples coming together, you know, in the Antilles to create a society. You know, if you can picture it in your mind, from a pictorial sense to get a vision, okay. Sebastian, He says, and I believe this is in Taino astronomy and in Taino mythology, he says the magical transformation of human bones in fish is the first in a series of metamorphoses in Taino mythology, explaining the supernatural origin of natural things. So as we advance, like you're going to see more examples of this, how through each time they left the cave, you know, there's a transformation or a pinnacle where pieces of Taino society came to be. Okay? If you read Indigenous People of the Caribbean, page 104, Henry Petit Jean Roget, he says, one of the myths collected by Panay's relatives, how at the beginning of time, out of the earth, which was unformed, flat, rises a unique mountain in which there are two caves. Then as the narrative unfolds, there is only one cave in which resides the future of humankind. So in referencing humankind, this is referencing to Taino society, because as you read Bainé's account, you know, they're telling you how their society came to be. And I have to keep putting that in your mind so you can see the picture. The task of one of the residents is to separate the men from the women. This he fails to do successfully, and he is condemned to remain at the entrance of the cave, where he is transformed by the sun, a male metaphor, into a stone statue, and his name is Makokarel. So when you look at the beginning, right, of Panay's account, and the best breakdown is by Jose Juan Aram, who made the transition a few years back. He crossed over. Okay, when they're talking about, there was a region called Kaunau, in which there was a mountain called Kauta. They're talking about a mythological place in which they are using it as a metaphor to describe how the community came into existence on the islands. And in another quote, the men had wandered some distance from the cave, the primordial uterus, in which incest was practiced as a matter of necessity, because at the beginning of time, all human beings were brothers and sisters who had risen out of the same cave, the same womb. Makokarel remains close to the cave of origins on the side of the undifferentiated beings, the Samis. And this is a quote that is taken from the Indigenous People of the Caribbean, page 104. Okay, so you can check that out. So at the very end of the first chapter, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, right, when they bring up Makokarel, you know, Makokarel was trying to do something to bring the people out of the cave, and something happened. Okay, and this eventually leads to the separation of the men and the women. And if you follow the story, they were in the cave. They were not yet manifested physically on the islands. So all of these, once again, they are metaphors. So as we can continue, the separation of the men and the women, this is the journey of Wahiona. It happened that a man whose name was Wahiona told another who was called Yaubaba to go and gather a plant called Digo, with which they clean their bodies when they go to bathe. He went out before dawn, and the sun caught him along the road, and he was turned into a bird that sings in the morning. Now, in the first instance, a man was turned into a stone. Now a man is turned into a bird. Pay attention. that sings in the morning. And he is called Yahubaba Yael. Seeing that the man whom he had sent to gather the digo did not return, Wahiona resolved to leave the Kasiba Hawa cave. So in the first instance, Makokarel attempted to leave the cave. He was transformed into stone. Yahubaba attempted to leave the cave to get a plant. He was turned into a bird. So being that the people that he had sent to gather the plant, which was in this part was referred as digo, Wahiona resolved to leave the Kasiba Hawad cave. Are you following? So from this, we can see that Taino society manifested through a series of stages of magical transformations. A good example from that is if you study the works by Osvaldo Garcia Gocco, there's a chapter that he gives a good breakdown on the different manifestations. Also, Sebastian Wobbe Lamacha in Mythologia, Religion de los Taínos. That's also a good citation, which we're gonna give you more in a second. Okay, so a transformation is like in comparison to shapes changing and taking different forms. Okay. Some of this can be similar to the Popol Vuh because they also have a similar narration, just so you can have a picture in your mind. Okay, now from Panay's account, the following is how it follows. Okay, so check this out. Okay, there's a man turned into stone. People turned into trees. Man turned into a bird. Children turned into frogs. A man turned into a kobo, which is a conch shell. A woman heals a man and transforms him into a cacique slash priest or behike, just to get that picture in. A woodpecker makes women from caracaracoles. A son's bones is turned into fishes. A dying mother gives birth to four elements. A gourd breaks and water fills the whole earth. The sun discovers the secret of fire. The sea turtle emerges from the sun's back. And from all of that, Taino society begins. Okay? Now, there are several mentions to the plant, and many people got confused in what was Panay identifying in the creation myth, which Lacasas clarifies in the second book of the Apologetic History of the Indies, and I'm going to give you the citation. But first, I'm going to explain this. The word digo is a corruption of the word indigo. Okay? Which comes from Spanish and Portuguese. And you can look, if you look in the Chambers Dictionary for Etymology, you're going to see it. Okay? So, it comes from Spanish and Portuguese, the word indigo. Indigo from the Spanish, indigo from Portuguese. And indigo from the Dutch, by Portuguese influence. The word digo is derived from the Dutch word indigo, meaning indigo pigment. Okay, and this is, you can find in the Chambers Dictionary of Etymology. Now, just to get an overview on that, I'm going to give you another example. So just bear with me. I'm just looking for the page. Okay, 1 second. Okay. So in Panay's account, right, he gives the following, right? It's either as Digo, Will, or Sakon, either one, right? Aram notes that Eula also calls it. Now, by the way, Bane's account, right, the original document is supposedly lost. So the document was copied by Afonso de Eula, which he made a translation in Italian, which the account is based off of. It's based off Afonso de Eula's Italian translation, which Jose Juan Aram does great works in correcting the errors in that document. So from that, Aram Jose, he says, Wuyi, or G-I-O-I-E, in comparison to Wheel, he says in his commentary, in Italian means jewels. He says that it's an enurous reading of the name of the plant called Wheel. Wheel and Digo are the same plant, okay? Which in the story, as the way they write it, as Aram Jose translated, that makes the citations confusing. Okay? Aram omits the chapter where La Casas clarifies the identification of the plant, which I'm going to show you in a few. Right? Eula also spells it as G-U-E-I-O, Wheel. Instead of the Y, they use the I. Right? The Indians of the Guayanillas called a plant Weya. Okay? And you're going to find this in Aram, Jose Juan Aram's translation of Bane's account in his commentary, if you look, which was an herb that was mixed with tobacco, possibly to appease hunger. This is what Jose Juan Aram writes, right? And it's also known by the name Sakon. Okay, so from this, Digo, Wheel, and Sakon, they are the same plant, if you follow the story carefully, right? Bane, he says, they take an herb that is called Wheel, which has stick long leaves similar to those of the basil plant and is also known by the name Sakon. Okay, Fernando Ortiz, he writes, among the Indians of the Guayanillas, tobacco is apparently chewed for which purpose it is mixed with a certain salty tasting ashes obtained from a species of plant called alga. They gather near a river and alga the Indians called Weya. Right? The Digo or the Wheel could have been a plant that was mixed with a certain type of tobacco. Right? As I go along, you're going to see more of what I'm speaking of. Okay, so just let me backtrack 1 second. Okay, so we're going to give you an order, a summary of the Taino cosmogony. A cosmogony, like cosmology, is describing the structure of an oral tradition of a people. Okay? So from studying Bane's account, right, there are several examples, which I have five I'm going to give you right now. Right? The transformation of Macarel into stone symbolizes the creation of the mineral kingdom. The transformation of fishermen into hobos is the creation of the plant kingdom. The transformation of Yaubaba into a bird is the creation of the bird kingdom. The transformation of children into frogs is the creation of the amphibian kingdom, the kingdom of the frogs. The transformation of Yael's bones into fish and the great flood from the broken gourd is the kingdom of the sea. So Osvaldo Garcia Goco and Sebastian Roby La Mancha, they give examples of these. How Taino societies was manifested through a series of different manifestations. Goku writes, born the sun and the moon in the cave of the cosmic vagina of the mother. So the cave symbolically is a representation of the womb, represented by the circle and the dot. Okay, Henry Petit Jean Roget, he says, the natives describes the origin of Taino society, animals or the sea. The Digo, a hero, is sent in search for the most valuable magical plant. The Digo, which is a wild tobacco, used for purifications. Okay, in each stage in the Taino creation narration, okay, each stage in the creation story is narrated by a process in which Taino society came into being in the Antilles. Stevens Arroyo, he says in the Cave of Jagua, within an exogamous system, incest prohibits marriage to persons from the same clan as well as sexual relations with one's parent or sibling. The myth has dictated the prohibition of incest. It has narrated the phases of mineral, vegetable, animal, and other various elements through which humankind has gone before establishing its societies and rules. So an example of that is the word exogamy. Exogamy is the process in which people marry outside of their community within their linguistic groups. The transformations in which the creation myths can be compared to the changes of geometric shapes as the shapes proceed to emanate out an act of creation like a child developing in the womb, as the geometric shapes changes at will. Okay, Wahayona Stellar Journey. Wahayona leaves the caves. He takes all the women, leaving the children behind, and embarks on a journey. There was a crisis as they needed a solution as to how to distribute the people. Separating the men and the women, and this is from chapter 2, who were still in the Kasiba Hawa cave. Right in chapter 3, he says, leave your children, let us take only the plant with us, for afterwards we will return for them. Right, as the plant is an indication of incest. La Casa says in the Apologetic History, now please follow carefully, chapter 167, the abstinence was that they retreated for 6 or 7 days without eating anything except certain juices of herbs so as to not to weaken altogether, with which juice they also washed their bodies. The plant clearly was associated with purification as a result of incest. Right in chapter 4, Wahayona departed with all the women and went in search of other lands, arriving in Matinino and later Wanin. This is the canoe trip, or the account of the people populating the Antilles. Leaving small children next to a stream, the children cried with hunger to their mothers, who could not nurture them, asking for the breast with great desire to be nurtured or breastfed. The children were transformed into little animals like frogs, and in this way, those men were left without the women. Okay, now, La Casa says in chapter 69 in the Apologetic History of the Indies. Okay, now this I have all three volumes of the Apologetic History of the Indies, which is it's an anniversary edition that was published in Mexico. All three volumes, I got it from Spain. I went through a lot of trouble to get it. Okay, but in chapter 49, on the island of Hispaniola, a plant is dried in the sun and made of sheets of dried leaves. It was smoked or chewed, causing numbness of the body, as an appetite suppressant, so no hunger or fatigue is felt. The leaves are called tobacco, and that's in page 628 in book 2. So indeed, the plant digo, wheel, and sacón is a form of tobacco, and La Casas clarifies this. Okay, so we know the plant that Wahayona carried was a type of tobacco. Okay, Sebastian Robert Lamanche, he says, this part of the myth in the Taino creation story reminds us of a South American Wario myth in which men are deprived of tobacco because it has been taken away to an inaccessible island by some unmarried women. Okay? Unmarried women in Fainé's account is represented as looking for linguistic groups to marry into. Like if you study Irvin Rose as a basis, he describes how Taino society is marked by an Arawakan base. Because in comparison to the material culture and the language, it has an Arawakan base, meaning the language and the material culture is mainly rooted in the Arawakan or Orinoco region. You know, and this is not excluding the other elements between the relationships between other peoples. But this is their foundation. Right? If you study Kalinago or Carib, also Garifuna, they have an Arawakan base. Okay, so these are important references I'm throwing out there for you to go and research and do homework. So check it out. Wheel was some kind of tobacco, the dried leaves that they valued very highly. The crying, the hungry children with variations is widely throughout all of South America. Okay? So Sebastian, he draws from Levi-Strauss, who gives examples. The Boreal Indians of Brazil attribute the origin of stars to a group of hungry children who, having cut the women's grandmother's tongue, ascended to heaven to become stars. In other Chaco myths, the origin of the Pleiades is ascribed to children dragged to the sky after behaving noisily. South of the Orinoco River, the Makushi, believe that the Pleiades came into being when seven brothers, incessantly crying for food, decided to become stars and ascended slowly while singing and dancing. Okay, and this you can find in Astronomy and Taino Mythology. This is where Sebastian Roby Lemaître speaks about this. The crying of the children marked the beginning of Wahayona's stellar journey in the Caribbean. The transformation is also seen as an initiation. And that's from Stevens Arroyo, page 147, the Cave of Hagua. Okay, the sound of crying is also seen in comparison to the sound of non-stop rain. You know, just stop and think about that for a minute. Okay, now we're going to get into how afterwards the women re-embark on the island of Quisqueya, which they call today Hispaniola. When Wahayona left, taking away all the women, he took the wives of his cacique, Anacacuya, deceiving him as he deceived the others. Wahayona's brother-in-law, who was called Anacacuya, was in the canoe, which he looked into the sea. When Wahayona said, "Look, what a handsome kobo there is in the water." Right, as we said before, the kobo is the conch shell, which is also called the lambi. Anacacuya looked into the water, and Wahayona took him by the feet and throws him into the sea, taking all the women he had for himself, leaving the women in Matinino. The women in Matinino represents the unmarried women from the other tribes. Wahayona goes from Matinino and went to another island, Wanin, which is symbolic of going from island to island, like in a sense island hopping, which Erving Rose attempts to make a description in using technical terms in his book, The Tainos. Okay, Jose Juan Aram says, Anacacuya means central spirit or star of the center. Aram Jose notes, Anacacuya is the mythic representation of the pole star, and that the passage codifies the Taino meteorological knowledge of phenomenon related to the seasons of rain and drought. Sebastian also says Anacacuya became Polaris in order to make possible the first journey in the canoe. Frogs are first a universal symbol of water. To Aram, the words toa toa, from which crying out, means water, or an imitation of the frog's song, which represents rain, right? Representing the long periods of Arawakan migrations throughout the Antillean Islands, which in the very beginning, the early 19th century, they were either called Arawaks, Island Arawak, and then eventually the term Taino, which the term Taino today is used as a general term in describing a community of peoples, archaeologically. It's an archaeological term as it is applied. Eugenio Fernandez Mendez, he says, Raymond Brenton tells us that the Carib Indians said that the little dog and the big dog, the little bear and big bear, caused the hurricanes and the winds from the east. Brenton, in referring to the West Indians, says that the savages, so-called savages, which we know they're not savages, you know, take good care not to get out of the sea. Let me say that again. In referring to the West Indians, he says that the natives take good care not to get out the sea when they observe this constellation rising from the sky. right? So as Panay continues the account, right? So we traced in the beginning, you know, the people were attempting to leave the caves. And every time they left the caves, there was a transformation. Okay? So from that, eventually, they were in desperate need in searching for a magical plant. And since an individual failed to return to the cave, Wahyona was forced to leave the cave to embark on a journey. Right? And continuing, Panay, he says that, they say that Wahyona was in the island which he had gone, and he saw that he had left a woman in the sea, which gave him great pleasure. And at once he sought many libations to bathe himself, because he was full of sores, which we called French disease. She placed him in a wanata, which means a place apart, and Wahyona recovered from his sores. The sores were a result of incest, the brothers and sisters copulating with each other in the caves, as Panay compared it to the French disease syphilis. Henri Petit Jean Roget, he makes another mention of this. He says that at the beginning of time, all human beings were brothers and sisters who had risen out of the same cave, the same womb. Arroyo, he cites, in many puberty initiations, such as that of the Tucano and the Yanomamo, a menstruating woman seeks seclusion in the forest. Like other tales among the South American peoples, the trip explains the social rules for marriage. Now, this is from Stevens Arroyo. This is what he says. You know, that was his citation. That... Like other tales among the South American peoples, the trip explains the social rules for marriage. You know, so whenever you hear the word exogamy, you know, that's a sense of describing how they arrange marriages within different linguistic groups. A good example is a good book called The Palm and the Pallades, which later I'm going to give you the name of the author, so just bear with me. Arroyo, he says, in South America, the significance of Orion as a weather indicator varies according to climate. Inland, Orion's appearance means rain, hence more difficult fishing. Among the coastal flatlands of the Indians of Guyana. Wabanito shares similarities with other South American myths, Arroyo says. He says in the mythology of other South American peoples of the Warawao, the woman at the bottom of the waters is the guardian of tobacco and of the other women alone on the Amazonian island. Arroyo also says, like similar myths which refer to incest, refers to an incest taboo, this myth may be a confirmation of exogamy. Okay, there's also two brothers that break this down in a book called Cuban Aboriginal Mythology. So I'm just going ahead of myself, just to give you those examples there. The relationship between Wahyona and Wabonito was a denial and mastery of sexual desire, symbolically, not in a literal sense. Was a denial and mastery of sexual desire learned in the isolation of the Wanata. This woman was called Wabonito, Panay says. And Wahyona changed his name, calling henceforth Abe Borel Wahyona. Wabonito gave Abe Borel Wahyona Maniwanins and Sibas. It is said that Wabonito, Wahanyona, and his father were the origin of these Wanins. So we know that many South American tribes, when a priest treats the sick, you know, they embark on a new name because it's taking on a new cycle. Okay, and this you can study, you can go look in the languages of the Wanias. You know, there are many examples, but a good example to start, you know, get an account of the Antiquities of the Indians, which was a translation that's put together by Jose Juan Aram. That's a good place, that's a good point to start. And he gives you all the citations in the footnotes. So that's a very important book, which is a small book that has a lot of information. Okay, so the Wanins and the Sibas represents the exogamous kingship. Wabonito, Wahanyona, and his father are an indication of the exogamous lineage. So if you study the very beginning of the account, this is what they break down. William F. Keegan, he says that women are the power behind the throne. Because as we know, Taino society was mainly a matrilineal society, meaning the women held the social political structure together. Now, making a comparison to the myth of extinction, if you study the works by Tony de las Casas, more specifically the destruction of the Indies, that's the template that they use for the myth of extinction, because all of the structure for the basis in creating such a myth, it comes from Bartolomeo de las Casas. Right, Cuban Aboriginal Mythology by Jose M. Gurach del Monte and Alejandro Quejeta Barcelo, right, they say the chief of the Antillean struggle for exogamy, diffuser of the Sibas, the Wanins, the Wahanyona was only among the inhabitants of the Kasiba Hawa cave until it was decided that it would be he who would distribute the Arawaks over the confines of the earth and found the herb which would cure the ulcers and the pulses affecting many of them who were in the caves. Together with Wabonito, he applies a treatment which would cure him and his people, which in a mythological sense, marrying with other tribes. Right? How women was returned to the island. Okay? And we're up to, and this is from chapter 7 of Parnay's account. He says, they say that one day the men went to bathe, and while they were in the water,
I had to come back inside because the battery died, obviously. But just to give a quick recap, when you are reading Parnay's account or chronicles, right, each account is individual, but it's relating to the whole. So although the creation stories, they appear to be singular or fragmentary, but if you're able to picture them together coherently, you are going to be able to grasp the representations in Barnet's account. So I'm going to continue where I left off, which was on how women returned to the island. Right? So Barnet, he says that they say that one day when the men go to bathe, when the men went to bathe, and while they were in the water, it rained a great deal, and they felt a great desire to have women, and that often when it rained, they went to search for the tracks of their women, but they could not find any sign of them. But that day, as they were bathing, they say that they saw some kind of persons fall from some trees, coming down among the branches. Okay, so in this part of the story, right, the account deals with the desire of the men wanting women to procreate their descendants. Quote, when they were in the water, it rained a great deal. That is symbolic of a man desiring a woman, or perhaps having connections to other marriage myths. Arroyo writes, the opening lines of this episode repeat the identifications of the rainy season with the approach of a woman's sexual receptiveness. Here, the creatures have never been mothers. However, their receptiveness to sexual relations is the first time experience. And like the South American myths listed above, probably refers to girls before puberty, a mythic explanation of marriage rites. Related to the account of the remote women, the desire for women is related to water. Not only in bathing, but especially in the increase of rainfall. So let's remember, let's not forget the people being in the water, the desire to have women, and the association with rain. All right, so this part of the story mediates the encounter of men and women, Arroyo says. These forms were neither men nor women, nor did they have the sex of the male or the female. And they went to seize them, but they fled as if they were eels. You follow? The roughness of the creatures to catch the beings that appear to be women to them is associated with the account of incest from the beginning of the story. They had scabby skin, the result of mating with one another inside the cave. Okay? And is possibly connected to other South American marriage accounts. The story displays the temper of the men to catch the women to have sex with, to have them symbolically as their linguistic wives. Please follow this carefully. Therefore, by the order of their cacique, because they could not seize them, they called two or three men to see how many they were, and to seek out each one a man who was a caracaraco, because their hands were rough and thus they might hold on to them tightly. They told the cacique there were four of them, and so they took four men who were caracaracoles. After they had seized them, they took counsel on what they could do to make them women, because they did not have the sex of the male or the female. Okay, Arum says it is no accident that the beings the men were attempting to catch were four in number. The number four, sacred to many Amerindian cosmogonies, the brothers and sisters of Taino society created by the gods. That's my emphasis. As it was a magical account. They looked for a bird called Inriri, and likewise they took those women without the sex of the male and female, and they tied their hands and feet, bringing the bird, tying the bird to their bodies. The bird, believing they were trees, began his work, picking and burrowing holes in the place where the sex of the women is generally located. And in this way, the Indians say they have women, according to the stories of the most elderly. The bird obviously represents the phallic symbol, the metaphor for procreating. As they recite this, this is how they had women, by way of procreation. Enriri Kaobaba Yael picks and burrows a hole in the place where the sex of the women is generally located, clearly associated with the process to go out and to find unmarried women to have as their wives. This account, it is associated and symbolic of chaos and order in Taino society, the Taino hierarchy. The loss of the women throughout the story represents the imbalance. The lack of having unmarried women to have as wives or potential mates. And the order created from finding women to have as their mates explain the social order of an exogamous relationship. Stephen Hugh Jones gives an example in The Palm and the Pylades. Quote, women ensure the reproduction of people. Men ensure the reproduction of society. Now, when you read Barnet's account, he gives the confusion, or the narration gives the confusion, that he wasn't sure of what came first or what came last. But in spite of that, you have to understand all of the accounts, they are all individual, they all appear to be fragmentary, but they all relate to a whole, they all connect. If you know how to follow the story, you will see how it would make sense. You know, the account begins with describing the order of the social political hierarchy in Taino society and how through each steps there was a magical transformation that eventually brought forth the manifestation of the social political culture onto the Antilles. So with that, we're going to move on to the creation of the sea, which leads into the manifestation of Taino society in the Antilles. There was a man called Yahya, and his son was called Yahyael. Because Yahya wanted to kill his father, the latter sent him into exile, and thus Yahyael was exiled for 4 months. Yahya being sent to exile represents the strict exogamy laws. The relationship between Yahya and Yahyael is the relationship of the linguistic tribes marrying into the communities, creating an allegiance or bond. Yahyael challenging his father represents the interchangeable roles between a big chief or a lesser chief within a given linguistic radius. An example of this is, once again, when I made mention of the matrilineal society that is Taino society, which was mainly the foundation was laid upon the women, because the women laid the social constructs for the rights, the deeds, and the treaties of the lands and the allegiance between the given communities within the regions, both far and apart. Aram says Yahyael's attempt to kill his father describes a symbol for the refusal to migrate. So once again, this is in connection with the strict exogamy laws, as I just previously recited moments ago. Okay, Stephen Hugh Jones, in relations to this, he says, using this sense, the term tribe refers to a large group of people who share a common cultural tradition, who speak a number of related languages or dialects, and who live in a more or less continuous geographic area. For this reason, both Indians and ethnographers make use of language as a criterion for defining units of social structure. The ideal coincidence of language unit and exogamous group boundaries leads the Indians to use language as a way of talking about descent. So in a sense, when you are reading Binet's account, what they are doing is they are describing to Binet their lineage of descent in their society and how they came to be or how they came about on the islands. From a general perspective, when we are composing this dialogue, right? So, Stephen Hugh Jones also says, by a tradition of common ancestry, by strict rules of exogamy, and in most cases, by possession of a common language. An example is the relationships between Kalinago, Garifuna, and Lokono. Please remember this. Afterwards, his father killed him and put his bones in a gourd and hung it from the roof of his house, where it was hanging for some time. The bones represents the ancestral lineage or the linguistic correspondence to other tribal communities. The bones can also represent the physical realm or the material human condition, as the gourd representing the will to materialize through the womb of the woman, through birthing. So birthing is another metaphor, such as the breaking of the gourd in the creation story. The birthing or the breaking of the gourd is another metaphor to describe descent. Arum notes, the custom of hanging the bones in a basket or keeping them in a funerary urn, as we continue to do today in the present, was noticed by Columbus on his first voyage. What I'm making reference to is how we put ashes in the urn when we cremate our relatives who have crossed over. So I'm making that reference, in a sense, to that. Yaya is the supreme essence or vitality. There is no indication of Yaya being superior over other entities, and I'm going to explain that further. The account between Yaya and Yaya El is an individual account, obviously describing a social political structure of a people. The relationship between Yaya and Yaya El can be symbolic of the exogamous hierarchy in Taino society in the Antilles. Now, there's a book on describing the myths of the natives of Wayania, that the supreme being has many names, many forms, and many titles. So when you look at the name Yaya and or correspondences to other systems, like in Kabbalah, you have Ketor, or in the Kemetic spirituality, you have Atum, right? Represents the totality of the all, right? And through emanations, you know, like a flower sprouting its seeds onto to the grass, represents the different cosmic attributes of the one being. An example of this I'm going to give in what Ra'u Nefer describes in Medonetta Volume 1, which he describes as the undifferentiated consciousness, right? In reference to the word God, right, is supposed to be a general term for the supreme being, which is a broken down term in the English language. You know, it doesn't really give explanation to what is, you know. The word God is in a literal sense. So unless you really study one's way of living, you're never really going to grasp what they really represent. To backtrack, the account between Yahya and Yahya El is an individual account, obviously describing a social-political structure of a people. Once again, this is referring to the Taino hierarchy, which is symbolic between Yahya and Yahya El, or in other words, the exogamous relationships between the lineages of the women, or the unmarried women becoming wives to the men. The relationship between Yahya and Yahya El can be symbolic of the exogamous hierarchy in the Taino society in the Antilles, and necessarily not a high god having dominion over a set of lesser gods comparable to the Bible. Now, when you're reading Bainé's account, there are a lot of authors such as Stevens Arroyo that like to make comparisons with Greek culture and biblical characters. Now, when you are studying Bainé, to grasp what Bainé is speaking about, you need to study ethnographic comparisons that is relating to the linguistic stock. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that is you need to be familiar and make comparisons between or correspondences between other Arawakan groups. Which at the end of this video, I'm going to give you the citations where you can go and study and do your homework and you're going to see for yourself. But once again, in order to get a grasp of this, you're not going to be able to get the picture between studying, making the comparison between biblical characters and Greek characters, because that's a different system and a different mindset. Okay, in order to grasp this social-political structure of the Taino hierarchy, we need to study correspondences in Arawakan communities and those that relate to it. Good examples are from that's given by Eugenio Fernandez Mendez, Osvaldo Garcia Gorgo, Sebastian Robio Lamarche, and also Stevens Arroyo. But to note on Stevens Arroyo, He makes some references between biblical characters, which the way that he writes is, in a sense, he sticks to the linguistics in comparing linguistic Arawakan groups, but then he goes off in using other metaphors like describing from biblical accounts, which it can be confusing for someone that is not familiar with not just ethnographic comparisons when it comes to studying Bainé's literature, but just the realm of Taino in general. It's going to be very difficult to grasp an idea. So if you're going to get a picture of this, you need to stick to studying Arawakan correspondences and relating to those Arawakan linguistic groups, because that's the way that you're going to be able to put those keys back together and gain an understanding and pass them on to your children, and rightly so. But more so, the structure between linguistic groups sharing a common language. Once again, now I've been mentioning a lot of language here. Very important. This should not be viewed as a polytheistic system from a Christian perspective, as I said before. On the grounds that the diverse titles represents the exogamous manifestations of cosmic lineage of the Taino people. As language is used in tracing the source of origin as a cultural base. Remember what I said. It happened one day that Yahya, desiring to see his son, said to his wife, "I want to see our son Yahya El." And Yahya's wife was glad. And taking down the gourd, she turned it over to see the bones of their son. And many fish, large and small, emerged from it. The bones represents the bones represents the ancestral lineage or blood memory, the genetics or the DNA. The transformation of bones into fish, both large and small, represents the different linguistic groups. With the breaking of the gourd and the later account of the flooding of the sea, the result of the exogamous marriage, Yahya and his wife bring down the gourd only to see that their son's bones turned into fish. The fishes in the gourd represents the linguistic groups who have yet to materialize in the Antilles. As the birthing of a female turtle from Damiens' back represents the materialization of what will be Taino society. As I walk you through the rest of the account, it's going to make sense. As they were in a realm not yet accessible to the physical world yet, meaning that all of this is in a symbolic sense, as they were using metaphors in front of Pané to give them a description in how the world came to be. Because when the Spanish came, they could not fully comprehend the language of that time, because their only interest was about attaining resources. Arroyo, he cites in Santeria, writes in which the hollow gourd is considered to be a womb. The gourd is the container for culture, such as language. As the child develops, the mother passes on an impression of her culture and her linguistic base onto the child to be. This we can establish as a reference to the creation myth. The problem in overstanding the expression in these accounts is because scholars write it so literally, which is why, in my view, people were never able to fully grasp the story. So, like I said, once again, when you're looking at it from a point A to point B perspective, like looking at a Facebook timeline, it's going to be very hard to get an idea, you know, and especially if you're using the wrong comparisons to get the picture of the story, like I previously described a few minutes ago. Okay, so whereby seeing that those bones had been changed into fish, they resolved to eat them. They resolved to eat them is the beginning of the manifestation of Taino society. As the pages of their account, as they pass on their account to Pané. So continuing on, Pané's account, they say that thus that one day when Yahya had gone to see his conucos, which means possessions, which were his inheritance, his linguistic lineage, four men arrived who were the sons of one woman who was called Itiba Kaobaba, from one womb and identical. When Itiba died in childbirth, they opened up and took out her four said sons. In connections to this portion of the creation myth, Arum says the four twins seem to represent the four cardinal points. He says, Eugenio Fernandez Mendez says that there are historical records of contacts between the islands, as we previously noted in the beginning in this video, both to the north, the west, and the south, indicating the complex linguistic society that emerged in the Antilles that became known today as Taino. Aram says, Daniel G. Brinton writes, the number four sacred in all American religious religions and the key to their symbolism is derived from the cardinal points. The cardinal points identified with the four winds, who in the myths are the ancestors of the human race or the ancestors of Taino society in this sense. The winds is a way to exchange language throughout the four directions. By way of oral tradition and also by way of trade and commerce. Aram writes that the four brothers would be equivalent to the four Tezcatlipocas in the Mexica cosmogony and the four Bacabs of the Maya. Sebastian Roby Lamache also makes the same citation. Eugenio Fernandez Mendez has already noted the relationship of religious characters between Mesoamerica and the Greater Antilles. Now, the Taino society has an Arawakan base, meaning that they share material culture and religious ideas with the Arawakan linguistic groups. Now, in correspondence to the Mesoamerican region, they only share religious concepts. Example, they share a relationship of stone idols that are sitting in a seated position with their hands rested on the knees, such as expressing a meditative state. There's also an expression of the hunchback god or ancestor. There's also expression of the divine earth mother. And many other religious correspondences which they share. Irvin Rose says that the people were populated in two directions. One from the Yucatan and the second from the South American region. And continuing Panay's account, Deminan, one of the aforesaid brothers, inside Yaya's home, taking down the gourd that held Yaya'el's remains, who had transformed into fishes. Hearing Yaya returning, Deminan did not secure the gourd well, and so it fell to the earth and broke. They say that so much water came out of the gourd that it filled up the whole earth, and many fish came out with the water. And thus it was, they say, that the sea had its origin. The breaking of the gourd represents the birthing and the fishes coming out of the linguistic tribes that would later give rise to Taino society. As the four brothers move on, they reach their grandfather's Bayamanaco's door. They saw that he was making cassabe. The brothers went to see if they can get some bread, which Deminan went forward to ask Bayamanaco. Deminan asked for cassabe. His grandfather Bayamanaco spat wanwayo onto his back instead, giving Deminan the wanwayo instead of cassabe. The wanwayo is like male semen, a mixture of tobacco and an hallucinogenic herb, which they called cohoba, which was indigenous to their country. The wanwayo that was filled with the hallucinogen was the fertilizer or the father, or seen as the father. Made by the grinding of dry tobacco leaves, Aram says. which was introduced from South America, he says. This you can also find cited in Stevens Arroyo, The Cave of Jaguar. Arom says that the plant is known in the Dominican Republic as tamarindo de teta and in Puerto Rico as cojobana. Bayamanaco represents an old father passing on cultural rights to his eldest child, the result of Deminan asking for the casabe. Once again, Bayamanaco spinning the one wayo represents passing down cultural rights to the eldest child. As the casabe represents the material culture of Taino society. What I mean by material culture, it is the cultural base of Taino society. After this, Deminan turned back to his brothers in regret that he had asked for the casabe. Deminan tells his brother what happened and how Bayamanaco spat one wayo onto his back, which ached very badly. Then his brothers looked at his back and saw it was very swollen and that the swelling grew so much that he was about to die. Then they say they tried to cut it and they could not. And so taking a stone axe, they opened it up and a live female turtle emerged. And so they built their house and raised the turtle. Now, this is the final part. The swelling represented pregnancy in connections to the stone depiction of Atabe in Caguana in Utuado, Puerto Rico, or Borinquen, representing the physical manifestation of Taino society in the Greater Antilles, as the creation was marked by a series of magical transformation described throughout the story. Engendering sons and daughters, Pirito Mater writes, as if the shaman mimicking the pains that a woman endures during pregnancy, with the turtle representing the birth of Taino society. So, in closing, this is my overview in describing what the creation stories represents. Now, for further reading, these are the sources that I use that you can also use as well in studying this. Now, once again, several advice, what I'm going to give, what you need to understand when you're reading Pane's account or anything associated with Pane's account, is that each of the stories are all individual. They may appear to be fragmentary, but they connect to a source or they connect to a whole. Now, once again, to grasp Bane's story, you also have to have correspondences with the right linguistic groups, meaning you need to make comparisons with other linguistic Arawakan tribes or relating within or outside of the Arawakan base. Once again, Eugenio Fernandez Mendez, Ovaldo Garcia Coco, Sebastian Robio Lamarche, and also even Stevens Arroyo make these references. But in note, Stephen Arroyo's, sometimes he goes a little off because he mixed with biblical and also Greek characters. So try, whenever you see that, to deter from that, because you're never going to get a clear picture. So these are my references, which you should have in your library, or you should have some sort of reference to. Okay, An Account of the Antiquities of the Indians, translated by Jose Juan Aram. Jose Juan Aram is responsible for making correcting the corruptions in Alfonso de Eula's translations of Binet's text. So without the work of Jose Juan Aram, we won't have the works that is associated with the creation accounts and how we understand them today. The second references is by, the first is by Sebastian Robio Lamacha, is one of two. The first is in Astronomy and Taino Mythology, which you can request at the University of Texas Press. You can get a copy of the journal if you call and make a request, because that's how I got it. You can also do the same. And the second is his book called Mythologia y Religión de los Taínos. The next reference is by Antonio M. Stevens Arroyo, The Cave of Jagua. The next one, which is a very good one, is Cuban Aboriginal Mythology by Jose M. Gurach del Monte and Alejandro Quejeta Barcelo. It's also in Spanish. Which there's another book that they published, which is called Los Semis Olvidados. That's, or the Forgotten Semis or Ancestors. That's also a very good book. You should get that if you can find it. Two ways you can look. You can look through Amazon, which sometimes they're very expensive, or by Albed Books. And that's also a very good source to get out-of-print books. The next reference is by Eugenio Fernandez Mendez, which is Art and Mythology of the Taino Indians. The next one is by Osvaldo Garcia Godko, which is a book he wrote called Influencias Mayas y Aztecas en los Taínos de las Antillas Mayores, okay? Which he's also one of the big guys in the Taino Legacies Project, so don't front. The next one is Apologética Historia Samaria by Bartolín de las Casas. This is the anniversary edition that was reprinted, which was reprinted in Mexico, I believe. I have all three volumes of the Apologetic History. So this, what I have here, is the anniversary edition that was republished in the early 90s. The next is The Indigenous People of the Caribbean by Samuel M. Wilson. And the last but not least is The Palm and the Pleiades by Stephen Hugh Jones. So all of those are good references that will help you to understand Binet's account. Now, once again, in closing, if you're reading Binet's account from a point A to point B perspective, like looking at a Facebook timeline, you are never going to get the story. In order to comprehend Binet's account, you cannot look at it from a literal sense. You have to look at it from an abstract sense, because when the Spanish arrived to the Antilles, you know, they encounter a different mindset of people. You know, those times was a different times compared to currently here in the present. So we have to keep our minds open in that if we are going to learn and grasp and begin to bring the pieces back together to pass it on to our children so that we can keep the fire going. So with that said, I hope this video was of some assistance and had given you some insight. And I hope that this generates more dialogue for future generations and aspiring students and researchers to come. So with that, I say peace and give thanks. All right.